that, and here's the standard, the principle that the court articulated, that the court said that if there is a generally applicable neutral law that is not targeted at religious practices, but is, applies to everyone, that you, that the free exercise clause is no defense. Is no defense. You suffer the consequences as being a member of this, the society of laws. The court also says in dicta, in non-binding language, they say, many, of course, Oregon could have made an exemption for the Native American, through their political process, for Native American use of peyote during religious practice, during religious ceremonies, but they didn't. They weren't required to by the free exercise clause, and the fact that the political process didn't give them that exemption is the way it goes. Some states have given exemptions. California, I believe, being one of them. They give an exemption for everything else. They probably do for that as well. But Oregon didn't, and so no unemployment insurance. The reasoning, I think, is important to look at. And first the big picture. What's the big picture here? The big picture is, to what extent should citizens be given a pass from complying with laws that conflict with their religious practices? That's what we're all here to think about. To what extent should citizens be given a pass from complying with laws that directly conflict with their religious practices? That's the big picture question. By the way, no one disputed that that the belief of the Native American church was genuine and sincere and bona fide, that peyote was a sacramental, was a sacrament that was used and was important to their religion. No one disputed that. It wasn't a quick one that anybody was trying to pull you know, the wool over someone's eyes. One can easily imagine that in a religiously diverse and pluralistic society like ours, like this group's, and we're unique in one way, but we're diverse in others. But one can imagine in a pluralistic, a religiously pluralistic and diverse society, that the creation of numerous exemptions from generally applicable laws would create this patchwork of enforcement and patchwork of compliance that would thwart the policy objectives of our governments. One can imagine that. In fact, that was what Justice Scalia said when he was explaining this decision. He says, and I'm quoting him, the court, "We have never held that an individual's religious beliefs excuse him from compliance with an otherwise held valid law prohibiting conduct that the state is free to regulate." Anybody know their history well enough to know what case, famous case, did he cite for that proposition? United States versus Reynolds, upholding a law against polygamy back in the 1870s. So the law against polygamy challenged. The court says no, even though that's part of the fundamental religious belief, no. The court says, laws are made for the government of actions, and while they cannot interfere with mere religious beliefs and opinions, they may with practices. So it's an absolute that the government cannot control your religious beliefs or your religious opinions, but according to the court, at least this court at this time, actions are different. To decide otherwise, he said, would make the professed doctrines of religious beliefs superior to the law of the land, and in effect permit every citizen to become a law unto himself. Remember who's saying this. This is Justice Scalia. He says that to allow exemptions based on objections to this, because they interfere with religious practices, would cause religious exemptions from civic obligations of almost every conceivable kind. He says compulsory military service, payment of taxes, child neglect laws, compulsory vaccination laws, drug laws, traffic laws, child labor laws, and race anti-discrimination laws. It'd be a patchwork. And those important policy objectives underneath each of those statutes, which he was referring to, would be thwarted. So that was 1990. Then we get last year, Hosanna Tabor. And this one's written by the Chief Justice Roberts, and it's unanimous. This opinion's unanimous. And it needs to be juxtaposed with Smith. As I said, complexify, I don't think that's a word, but maybe confuse us all, maybe. And in Hosanna, the court, as I said, unanimously recognized the ministerial exception to employment discrimination laws. The ministerial exception. What is that? Well, first, the facts. In this case, the church involved was a Lutheran church, the Missouri Synod in particular. And that synod classified its school teachers in the primary and secondary levels as either called or lay. The called teachers were regarded as having, as you might expect, being called into their vocation by God, as we all have been. Called teachers had to meet certain requirements, including coursework in theology, and they were given a formal title of a minister of religion commissioned. On the other hand, lay teachers received no special training by the synod, nor were they even required to be Lutheran. They were lay teachers, and basically the record showed lay teachers were used when called teachers were not available. So Cheryl Parrish was a called teacher and a commissioned minister. She taught secular subjects, but also taught a religion class. She led students in daily prayer, and twice a year she actually led chapel services. She took a disability leave at the beginning of the academic year due to an illness. Halfway through the year, I think it was in February, she comes to the school principal and she says, "I'm better, I want to teach." The school principal says, "Problem is, we hired a long-term sub, we don't have a spot for you." She says, under the ADA, her illness was a disability under the ADA, under the American with Disabilities Act, "You have to give me a spot back." Principal says, "Don't have one." She says, "Well then, I think I'll probably sue you." Principal goes to the congregation and relays the fact. The congregation removes, takes her called status away from her, says, "No longer are you a called teacher," and shows her the door. That's it. She sues for retaliation. And under, as you all know, it's a no-no to discriminate on the basis of one of the protected classes, disability now under the ADA being one of them. It's a bigger no-no to retaliate against someone who threatens to exercise their rights. And that's exactly what she does. And that's exactly what they do. They don't deny it. We retaliated against her in the sense that she was going to sue us,
suits don't go over in a big way. For, you know, in our denomination, we have internal methods for handling disputes. And so we got rid of her. Facts are sort of not in dispute in that respect. But the school argues that if you recognize the validity of this suit, if you allow this teacher who's initially seeking to be reinstated, and then she later changed her relief to just money, you're telling us, the Lutheran Church, who our ministers should be, who our called ministers should be. And that completely violates all notions of free exercise and probably establishment too. You don't have the right, government, court, to tell us what we can and can't do in deciding who our ministers are. The defense to that was, and that may be true, Cheryl Parrish talking, but I'm not a minister in that sense. I'm not ordained. I'm not a minister. And the court said, well,